in the context of this interview, I consider complicated UTIs any UTI that hasn't resolved with up to a week of antibiotic therapy.
Antibiotics and treatment, which follows from testing. So first of all, I wanted to talk a little bit about antibiotic resistance, as there seems to be some confusion around that topic. There seems to be the belief that the person themselves develops antibiotic resistance rather than the bacteria that's involved. Can you kind of clarify what antibiotic resistance really means?
So antibiotic resistance refers to the ability of bacteria to not be killed by a given antibiotic.
So it's never the person that develops resistance to an antibiotic.
That is correct. That being said, we do know that there are important patient characteristics that can affect the pharmacology of antibiotics. For instance, the weight of a person, of course, that should not be very surprising, but also their percent body fat. So fat, of course, can metabolize and distribute antibiotics differently than lean body mass. Tissues also exhibit differences in antibiotic penetration. For example, the prostate, so often is a little bit refractory to antibiotic penetration. Mm-hmm. And so men with bacterial prostatitis often need several weeks of therapy.
Are any of those first items that you mentioned taken into account when someone is prescribed antibiotics, or is that more just knowledge that is not used in that way?
Well, at least amongst urologists, certainly the treatment of bacterial prostatitis for several weeks of antibiotics is accepted. Mm-hmm. The tailoring of antibiotic regimens based on those other parameters is highly provider dependent.
Okay. And so is antibiotic resistance something that is permanent, or does it change over time?
So antibiotic resistance certainly changes over time. That's based on extensive medical literature as well as my own experience. And the reason it changes is that the microbiome is very dynamic. So for a given bacteria to maintain resistance to a given antibiotic requires metabolic energy. Okay, and that is thought to result in what's called a fitness cost, meaning that if the bacteria is dedicating metabolic energy to resisting a particular antibiotic, it won't be able to, let's say, grow as well in the colon. And so if the antibiotic pressure is removed, then suddenly that bacteria no longer has a growth advantage and other bacteria will take over, and then that bacteria may entirely vanish or be suppressed.
Okay.
So antibiotic resistance also is dynamic because we know that bacteria can trade genes, including mm-hmm. genes that encode for antibiotic resistance. So antibiotic resistance is actually quite a complex biological process.
Does this mean if you separate the colonies of bacteria in testing and then do an antibiotic susceptibility test that you will get a different result than if you kept them together?
I do think that that can occur, and that has been demonstrated by others. And it's part of why I do think that there is a role in some patients for pooled antibiotic susceptibility, meaning that instead of testing individual bacterial colonies against one antibiotic at a time, putting together all different bacterial species detected in a given sample and testing them as a group mm-hmm. against individual antibiotics.
Okay. If testing shows that antibiotic resistance is present and that there is no single antibiotic that is likely to work, how would you move forward with treatment in that case?
So do you mean that there's no antibiotics available that would work? Yeah. So in patients who have multi-drug resistant bacterial UTIs, that's obviously a very difficult scenario to manage by definition. I will say that if they are minimally symptomatic, it's actually an option to not treat. We know that the immune system can clear UTIs spontaneously. Obviously, it can take longer without the assistance of antibiotics. But certainly in Europe, there have been a number of clinical trials demonstrating that for simple UTIs, and granted, many of my patients do not have simple UTIs, for simple UTIs, taking ibuprofen for symptom management is not inferior to taking an antibiotic. Now, for patients who are very symptomatic and have a multi-drug resistant infection, one option is to combine antibiotics that potentially may synergize with each other. And then another option, which I think is underutilized, generally speaking, is to use intravesical antibiotics. So there are a number of antibiotics that you can instill directly into the bladder through a catheter at very high concentrations that will kill bacteria that are considered resistant to the given antibiotic at the concentrations tested in the lab. But ultimately, you can achieve much higher concentrations of these antibiotics in the bladder than you can ever achieve with oral or even intravenous antibiotics.
I was going to ask you about bladder instillations and whether you use them. It sounds like you do. Is that something that is common amongst your patients or just in rare situations?
So I think instillations can be very useful for some patients. I try to reserve it for patients who, for example, have antibiotic-resistant infections, as we discussed. Patients who've had very extensive exposure to multiple antibiotics who are concerned about effects, detrimental effects associated with that. And also patients who've had significant gastrointestinal effects from antibiotic use.
And is the installation something that the patient does themselves, or is that done at an appointment?
So usually patients are taught how to do it themselves, but of course, the first session or two, the catheterization is performed in the office.
And is that kind of a daily thing that happens, or is it a one-off treatment?
So the regimen that I have recommended, and there are no large clinical trials to support this, but there are smaller studies in support of this, is installation of an antibiotic once a day for 3 days out of the week for several weeks.
Okay, so it's quite a few treatments then over that
It
time.
can be, yes.
Have you found that that approach to treatment actually helps patients to overcome long-term UTI, or is it something that they then still need to manage in the future?
I've had a number of patients who've had really remarkable success with bladder instillations.
Okay, that's interesting. What about long-term antibiotics? That question comes up quite a bit. Is that something that you use in your own practice? And when I say long-term, I mean full dose, not a prophylactic dose. Do you use that approach? And if so, or if not, why?
I do in select cases. There's a number of very important issues to consider in this situation. Several of the major urology specialty societies have issued guidelines regarding management of uncomplicated UTIs. And the word uncomplicated is very important here. Their recommendations are that for uncomplicated UTIs, patients should not be on an antibiotic for more than a week. And the reason being that they're trying to balance several considerations. One is, of course, they want to maximize, of course, likelihood of the patient resolving their infection. Okay. But they're also trying to prevent overuse of antibiotics, which we know promotes antibiotic resistance and also increases the risk of a given patient having undesirable side effects from an antibiotic. Now, for complicated UTIs, and the traditional medical definition of complicated UTIs is kidney infection or pyelonephritis, or of course, life-threatening infection. But, you know, in the context of this interview, I consider complicated UTIs any UTI that hasn't resolved with up to a week of antibiotic therapy. Okay. For those types of UTIs, I do think that the guideline does not apply. And then the question becomes, how long should patients be on an antibiotic? I'll generally start them with 2 weeks, again, as a attempt to balance the issues that I mentioned earlier. But I have had patients on antibiotics for 3 weeks, a month, or even several months.
Okay. Are there particular antibiotic classes that you think are more likely to penetrate the bladder wall if there is an embedded infection?
So we do know that ciprofloxacin, also known as cipro, and levofloxacin, also known as levoquin, have good penetration of urinary tissues. Bactrim also seems to penetrate tissues. Interestingly, genomycin, which is used for intravesical instillations, does not seem to penetrate into the lining of the bladder to kill any biofilms within those cells. Now, that being said, there is a theory out there that for patients who have an injured bladder, which is very common with UTIs, perhaps genomycin penetrates the tissues more readily, which would perhaps explain why, despite genomycin not being able to penetrate urothelial cells, which line the bladder, in normal circumstances can in a patient with perhaps chronic bladder inflammation from a persistent UTI.
Okay. Do you have concerns around using fluoroquinolones like cipro or levofloxacin?
I do. I do. And so do many patients. On the other hand, there's a significant segment of patients, not just in my practice, but in other people's practices, where the fluoroquinolones, cipro and levoquin, are one of the few oral options to treat their UTIs.
Do you use either of those in instillations, or is it just the gentamicin?
I try to be data-driven in terms of the antibiotics I use for instillations. So really, I use gentamicin as well as a second choice, neomycin with polymyxin B. There is some evidence that other aminoglycosides besides gentamicin can be used for instillations, such as amikacin, although I don't really consider gentamicin or amikacin really that different, since they're the same class of antibiotic.
Okay. Is the risk of antibiotic side effects, is it reduced if you do it via instillation as opposed to taking it as an oral antibiotic?
Yes. And in fact, that's one of the major reasons that for some patients, I do recommend consideration of instillations. The antibiotics used for instillations are known to not penetrate beyond the lining of the bladder.
Okay. Something that also comes up a lot in patient forums is the possibility that antibiotics have an anti-inflammatory element to them. And so I was hoping maybe you could explain that. Is there an anti-inflammatory impact of antibiotics, and could this be what is providing symptom relief in patients that whose symptoms return when they finish their antibiotics?
So, yes, there's very clear data that some antibiotics have clear, direct anti-inflammatory effects. Interestingly, the data is stronger for antibiotics that are not typically used for UTIs. I think it remains an open question whether the antibiotics used for UTIs have significant anti-inflammatory effects. And then I also think that antibiotics may have indirect anti-inflammatory effects. So for example, the immune system is very good, generally speaking, at knowing when to rev up and when to cool off. So when antibiotics are given and bacterial counts go down, the immune system in most cases cools off at that point. Antibiotics, frankly, also really don't work if you're completely immunocompromised, right? Mm-hmm. Many antibiotics are bacteriostatic, meaning that they don't outright kill bacteria, but they sort of freeze their growth. And then those antibiotics, of course, would rely upon the immune system to finish the job, so to speak.
Okay. And in that line of thinking, do antibiotics have any impact on nerve function or pain signals in the body?
Yes. So there is also data to that effect, which is also very interesting. There's also data suggesting that some antibiotics affect mitochondria in our cells. So the mitochondria are the energy powerhouses. Mm-hmm. And so that may also be part of the explanation as to why antibiotics can help relieve UTI symptoms. Mm-hmm.